Welcome to part 5 of the module project. This video is about the question, why is the Earth so dry? When we look at Earth from space, it seems to be covered with water, but the water that we see is actually just in a shallow layer on the surface. If you take all the water and put it together in a sphere, it makes a sphere of about the size of Texas. Actually, the total amount of water on Earth is not much, it's just 0.1% of the total Earth's mass. So the question that we want to address here is, why is the Earth so dry? So planets form in protoplanetary disks. The protoplanetary disks are illuminated by the central star, but the light from the star just hits the surface of the disk. So the interior of the disk is very cold. If just illuminated by the central star, the snow line would be inside of 1 AU. So all bodies forming at 1 AU or beyond should be very ice rich. And then, so the question is, why is the Earth so dry? Actually, the disk is not just heated by the stellar illumination. The disk is also in rotation around the star, and it rotates at different speeds as a function of the distance. The inner rings rotate faster than the outer rings. So there is some friction between the various rings of gas, and friction causes heat. And thanks to this heat, initially the snow line is much further from the sun, it's at about 5 AU. But the heat released by friction depends on the mass of the disk. And therefore, as the time progresses and the mass of the disk decreases, the temperature decreases and the snow line drifts inwards of 1 AU. So a planet growing at 1 AU like the Earth eventually should have accreted a lot of ice, which again raises the question, why is the Earth so dry? In the module project, we show that the formation of Jupiter sort of fossilizes the snow line. Let's see what this means. So let's take again a scheme of the protoplanetary disk. The inner part is warm, so water is in the form of vapor, so the gas in the protoplanetary disk is wet. Beyond the snow line, it's cold, the water has condensed in the form of icy pebbles, and therefore the gas in the protoplanetary disk is dry. Now, let's suppose for simplicity, for a moment, that icy pebbles don't drift in the disk. So the point to make is that the gas drifts towards the sun. It actually drifts faster than the snow line itself. So as time progresses, this boundary between the wet gas and the dry gas runs away from the snow line. The snow line, therefore, just sweeps the dry portion of the disk. And therefore, the part of the disk swept by the snow line remains ice-free because there is no wet gas to condensate there. But in reality, icy pebbles do drift in the disk, and they actually drift faster than the gas. And so as time progresses, the icy pebbles drift across the snow line where they sublimate their ice. And as a consequence, the boundary between wet gas and dry gas remains at the snow line, and just across the snow line, we can find icy particles. So these two animations show that if you want to understand the distribution of water and ice in the solar system, we need to understand the drift of particles. And this is where the formation of Jupiter comes into the game. So imagine a time early on when the disk is warm and the snow line is quite far out beyond 3 AU. So the planetesimals that form within the snow line form rocky by accreting only rocky pebbles, and the planetesimals that form beyond the snow line accrete icy by accreting icy pebbles. As time progresses, the disk cools and the snow line moves in. So these planetesimals, which have been swept by the snow line, even if they started accreting rocky, at some point they start to accrete icy pebbles and they become icy themselves. But at some time, Jupiter becomes massive enough, exceeds 20 Earth masses, at which point it creates this dust drift barrier that we discussed in part 3. So from this moment onwards, the icy pebbles will not be able to drift across Jupiter's orbit anymore. So even if the time progresses and the disk cools and the snow line moves closer to the sun, these planetesimals swept by the snow line will not accrete any ice because the icy particles are blocked beyond the orbit of Jupiter. And we have seen before that there is no local condensation of gas in absence of particle drift. Therefore, when you look at the distribution of planetesimals today, where are rocky planetesimals and water-rich planetesimals today, we see that is snow line separating the two, which is actually the fossilized location of the snow line, where the snow line was when Jupiter first exceeded 20 Earth masses. The formation of the Jupiter dust barrier has also other consequences. Since the formation of this barrier, the planetesimals inside the orbit of Jupiter and outside the orbit of Jupiter accrete from different reservoirs. The planetesimals outside of the orbit of Jupiter accrete pebbles coming from the outer disk, and the planetesimals inside of the orbit of Jupiter, if they keep growing, they do so by accreting recycled material indigenous from the inner disk. And this can explain why we have two populations of planetesimals which are vastly different from the chemical point of view and from the isotopical point of view. These are the planetesimals that are parent bodies of the ordinary and carbonaceous chondrites. And this implies that carbonaceous asteroids, carbonaceous chondrites, must have formed beyond the orbit of Jupiter. And recent analysis, chronological analysis about the timing of formation of these chondrites, argue that Jupiter must have formed within the first 1 million years of solar system history.
Mojo!